Good morning. Thank you, Karen, as she played Lord, Make Me an Instrument of Your Peace. It felt very peaceful. And we have come into a context today on this summer Sunday where the context that we have stepped into when we walked into the Lord's house today was the context of a relationship where humanity has been given the gift of peace with God. And that was forged for us by Jesus Christ. It was the plan of God to send the Christ to the world that we might have peace with God, and as a result, also have peace, inner peace, with ourselves and the lives that we live. So we celebrate God's goodness and a covenant of peace with God through faith. And we do that in part through our singing and celebrating of the Lord's goodness with us and for us. Now, our opening hymn, and this one is correct. Is that right, Karen? The closing hymn today has the right number but the wrong title. The closing hymn today is What a Friend We Have in Jesus is 403. Oh Jesus, I Have Promised was from last week. That was a computer glitch. I apologize for that. But the title is right with the hymn number for the first one. If you feel physically able to do so, would you stand at this time to sing For the Beauty of the Earth, 473. Please be seated. I would like to invite our children to come forward at this time for this morning's children's message. I hear the thundering herd coming down from the balcony. Morning. Where's Grace? Did she get lost? No? Is she here?
Yeah.
Is she coming? Oh, no. Here she comes. Well, good morning. What is your name? Nice to meet you. What is your name? Alea, nice to meet you. What's your name? Nice to meet you, Giovanni. And what is your name? Grant. And what's your name? That's great. Well, it's wonderful to have everybody up here today. Some of our friends aren't with us today. We've got a lot of families that are traveling and doing vacations right now. But I wanted to tell you about an idea that I had that came to me this week. It's the greatest idea. I want to hang a really bright light in the sky, and so that it will give us warmth and also light up the world so that we can see real good. Isn't that a great idea for a new thing? Does it sound like a new thing? It does? Maybe not so much, huh? Yeah, well, see, there already is a bright light in the sky, and it brings us warmth. I understand that these clouds that are covering it are going to go away a little later, so I'm told, and that we're going to be able to see it. What's it called?
The sun.
The sun, right. We already have the bright light in the sky that gives us warmth and gives us light so that we can see. And then the sky turns a beautiful color when the clouds go away. What color does the sky come? Yellow. Have you seen the whole sky turn yellow before? Blue. Thank you. Oh, my stars. So, anyway, who is it for? The sun is up in the sky, and it's warm, and it brightens up our day. Who is that for? Well, I think it certainly was for Jesus when Jesus lived here, right? Well, he did. He lived here. That was a little while ago. Who is it for now? All right, who is us? Yeah, who does the sun shine for? What do you think? Yeah. But who is us? Does it shine for Mr. Rick over there?
It's everybody,
that's right. The sun shines for everybody. You mentioned a name a few minutes ago. You mentioned the name Jesus. And Jesus is the Son, S-O-N, the Son of God, not like the sun in the sky, but he's God's Son. And the one thing that the sun in the sky and the Son of God have in common is that they've come for everyone. God sent Jesus to the world, the same as God placed the sun in the sky for us, or rather placed the earth around the sun is more accurate, but the purpose for both is that it's for everyone. It's for everyone's benefit that Jesus came, because he showed us the way of living in a way that we love one another and that we treat one another the way we would want to be treated. And that is intended for everyone. Now, not everyone has yet understood it, and not everyone has yet believed it, but the presence of Jesus in the world is to make life better for everyone. Just like the sun up in the sky makes our day better for everyone. I really hope that the clouds that come from the moisture, especially because we have the Great Lakes nearby, I hope they move away a little later today and show us the sunshine. And when that happens, I hope that we remember that this is God's gift for everyone. Let's pray together. Dear God, we thank you for the sun that shines in the sky. We thank you for your sun who shines in our hearts. And we pray that your love, revealed in the person of Jesus, would change the way we live life. And we pray that with faith and thanksgiving, in the name of Jesus, amen. Now, there is a special worship enrichment opportunity for children. My good friend and co-worker, Melissa, is in the back of the sanctuary. If you would like, you could go with her and have a great time this morning with children's worship. And if you choose not to, you're sneaking. If you choose not to, you could go sit with your families. Thanks for coming up. Bye now. For our time of intercessory prayer, as I mentioned, we have a lot of people traveling. One quick look around the sanctuary tells us that we're missing some faces that we're accustomed to seeing. And some of that is because we have people that are on different trips. So I know that, I think Susan's in Michigan, isn't that right? In New York. I got bad intel. Somebody told me Michigan, and I thought, ew. You'd have to take two showers when you got home. I'm kidding, of course. My children were actually born there. I know that the Andersons are traveling and the Struzakers are traveling. And there's a lot of folks who are traveling. We pray God's travel mercies on those who are. Also, because of traveling, a couple of our folks are not with us today. Sue Wigington was traveling last week, and while in Tennessee, she got some cold-like symptoms when she got home and tested positive for COVID. She felt rough for a couple of days, just like a bad cold, but she's feeling fine now, but has to quarantine. Also, Linda Bowles, whose family traveled here from North Carolina, one of her family members came down with COVID, so she was exposed to it. She is not testing positive, nor is she symptomatic, but she is quarantining. She came in a little early today to do something. It was all masked up. And so we're praying for those who have been exposed to COVID, and that if they catch the symptoms, that they will be like Sue had, that they are not terribly bad. I'd like to ask for prayer for a close friend of mine. His name is Ted Dunbar. Ted had open heart surgery. Kind of unexpectedly, he went in for his physical. They found an irregularity. They sent him for a stress test, and it didn't come back normal. He was feeling fine, but they did a catheterization. They found a total blockage of the widowmaker artery in his heart. And so they had to do bypass surgery on him, and they had to do it right away. And we're very thankful. He did not have a heart attack. I got to talk to him on the phone yesterday. He might even get to go home tomorrow. He's a very lucky man. But I ask your prayers for Ted as he makes this recovery. Also, for our families who have recently said goodbye to loved ones, and for Jan and Keith, who are among those traveling, celebrating 48 years of marriage, we wish a happy anniversary. And thanks to those of you who wished happy anniversary for Allison and myself, who celebrated 33 years on Friday. So I ask that we bring our joys and our concerns with us before God's mercy seat as we pray. Please pray with me. Blessed God, we know that your word says that you are watchful over our coming and our going, both now and forevermore. And we pray that you would watch over those who are traveling, those who are traveling to celebrate, those who are traveling to see family, those who are traveling and on vacation trips. And we pray that your sovereign hand will watch over and will regather us together in the days to come. We pray that you would help our families with children to enjoy some good time together before school starts back up, which is coming soon. We pray that you would prepare the way for a successful school year for our students and for our teachers. And we lift them up before you and ask that you would help to bless their efforts to have a good year of learning. We ask, dear God, that you would be with those families who have lost loved ones in recent days, for the Pondgrass family, for the Bowles family, for a number of our families, unfortunately, who have had to say goodbye to important people. And we lift up Gara Sauer's family today and pray that your healing spirit would be around and upon her and all of her family at the passing of her sister Penny this week. And know that it is a sad thing, and we pray that you would help to give your perspective that Penny needed a healing only you could give. And we are grateful that you have given that healing to her in the presence of your kingdom and have welcomed her into your presence by your Spirit. These are a sampling of the things that we brought with us today. We pray for healing for Ted and for others who are recovering from procedures. And we pray that you would be with Vern Adamson this week as he awaits a hip replacement surgery. And pray that your grace would attend him and that you would surround him with your care and that you would watch over Linda as Vern is recovering from this surgery. In all things, we have trusted in Jesus Christ. We pray in his name the prayer that he gave us to be a model for all of our prayers. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
At this time, there will be special music.
Savior, precious Redeemer and friend, who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of man? Oh, you rescue the souls of man. Counselor, you offer hope when our hearts have hearts always hunger for. Oh, our hearts always hunger for.
Couple of quick housekeeping items. There is an opportunity for us, a couple of different opportunities. If you are interested in helping make a contribution to repair the church's roof, the progress is coming along quickly. We are already have brought in, after just a couple of weeks, a little over half of the targeted amount to pay for the roof project. We were targeting $25,000, and we are already closing in on $14,000. So thank you to those of you who have made contributions to help to prepare to repair the roof. Also, there is an announcement in the bulletin today. Betty Natko's granddaughter Haley, with whom I spoke this week. Most of you have heard the story that she was traveling home from being with her mother, who had back surgery. She was not yet ready for her child to be born, but she came anyway. And she is in Chicago, she and baby, and they're going to be there a while. We're grateful for entities like Ronald McDonald House, and she's also had a friend who's helped her stay, but there are going to be things that she needs. If you would like to contribute to help Haley through this difficult time and through her family, the opportunity is there, and there is a paragraph in the bulletin that explains a little bit more in detail for that. Also want to remind us that we have our church picnic coming up. We're going to be doing that on site again this year. In the parking lot, so more details will be made available to that. I believe that's, is that next Sunday? Is the picnic next Sunday? Help me out, somebody. Or is it in 2 weeks? Anyway, it's coming up. There will be more information made available. So the book of Romans is one of the letters of the New Testament that is a handbook for Christian theology. And the text that I'm sharing with you from chapter 1 is the thesis statement of Paul's letter. It is the launching point from which all of the theology of Romans comes to us and gives us perspective that I believe will help us understand the whole picture of the gospel, who is Jesus Christ. So from chapter 1, I begin reading verse 14 from the book of Romans. I am obligated both to Greeks and non-Greeks, both to the wise and the foolish. That is why I am eager to preach the gospel also to you who are at Rome. I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. For in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Dear friends, this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And again, let us pray. Blessed God, we pray that you would give us a deepened understanding. And we pray that you would shine the light of your love on us, even as the sun shines to warm our face. Shine your love to warm our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. It's hard for us sometimes to relate to the language of the Bible because it was written 2,000 years ago, and we're hearing the words of the apostle come to us today and saying, I feel obligated to the Greeks and the non-Greeks. And that's all Greek to us. We don't understand what he means by that because a couple of reasons. We live in this great melting pot that is the United States of America. And also because we don't understand what he means by the term Greek there. What he meant by Greek, he's using the term Greek to refer to those who were not Jews. Because in Rome, just like in Galatia, and there's a letter in the New Testament to the Galatians, and at Ephesus, and there's a letter in the New Testament to the Ephesians, and at Philippi, and there's a letter in the New Testament to the Philippians, and Corinth, and so forth. In all of these places, there were Jewish people who had gone throughout the Roman Empire to the key trade routes. Thessalonica comes to mind, to the key trade routes because their businesses took them there and the opportunity for them business-wise was there to make a way, to make a living for their families. And the same was also true at Rome. There were Hebrew people in Rome, not a great majority of them, but there were some who were at Rome. And when the gospel came to Rome through the ministry of the Apostle Paul, it came to the few who were Hebrew people living in Rome, but also to the Italians. Majority of the people who were participants in the house churches at Rome were most likely Italians. So when the term Greek and non-Greek comes to us, we don't really relate to that. What we would be more apt to relate to is if the gospel had been written to the American Empire instead of to the Roman Empire, it would be more apt to us if the apostle had said to us, to those who are citizens and to those who are in the country as aliens with green cards trying to make a way, the gospel is coming to you, whether you're a citizen or a non-citizen, we would relate to that. That would be a statement and a perspective that we relate to. He said, I am wanting to bring the gospel to you at Rome, and I am not ashamed of this gospel. Why would he say anything about being ashamed of the gospel? Well, because Jesus died on a cross, the Romans believed that a person who died on the cross was being shamed, humiliated, and that they were stripped not only of their physical life, but of all sense of standing in the culture. Because it was the ultimate act of humiliation to crucify someone on the Roman cross. But Paul says, don't you worry about that. I'm not ashamed of this gospel. It's the power of God unto salvation. So he is bringing this power into a context. And the context he brings it into is Rome. And in Rome, there were a lot of practices that were not godly. In the Roman Empire, there were a lot of philosophies that had taken root. The Epicureans had the philosophy that you should eat as much as you want, drink as much as you want, eat all you can. In fact, they even had special rooms in their homes that were made for people to go and throw up so that they could go back to the dining area and then eat some more. It was indulgence. They literally called those vomitoriums. I'm not making that up. And it was indulgence to the max, to indulge the flesh in every way, including, you know, group sexual immorality and all kinds of just crazy things that we think, I can't imagine that anything like that ever took place. When someone tells you, I can't believe how bad the world is getting, the proper response is, getting? It's always been crazy. There have always been people in this corner or that corner of the world who got themselves into lifestyles and habits that were unhealthy or destructive to them. In fact, later in this book, the apostle says that some of the things that they were in the habit of doing were causing bad things to happen to their physical bodies as a result, a consequence of their bad decision making. Well, we all know what can happen to the physical body when we make bad decisions. It can create health problems for us. And so today, when you go to the doctor, you, whether or not you've ever smoked, you get lectured about smoking. They ask how much you drink and so on and so forth. Because of the idea is to have a healthier society. Paul wanted the society of the Roman Empire to take on not only a better physical health, but a better spiritual health. Because there's an emptiness about the shallow philosophies of the Roman Empire. And I want us to understand this. We live in the American Empire, and our empire is creeping down some of the same roads and has been for a very long time, creeping some of that down, some of those same roads where what we lift up, what we value, what we're blitzed with from our advertising campaigns and our media is to value things that are surface and shallow. And I'll give you an example. We present images of models to young girls who look and appear in magazine ads and even in video spots on the television or on their social media. And the way those young women are presented, who are the models, is not realistic. Women don't look like that. They're not supposed to. Many of these women have eating disorders who are serving as models. Some of them have plastic surgery to help them look a certain way. And we present that to the minds of our young ladies, and we find girls developing what? Bulimia and anorexia and other disorders in an effort to look like this unrealistic image that is being put out there that's based on what? What's the value system that makes us hold this up as this is what it's important to look like? It's important for you to look in such a way that you really can't achieve by normal means. And so what we're creating is an unhealth, not only of the body, but an unhealth of the spirit through the mindset. Later in the book of Romans, Paul says, do not be conformed to this world, meaning the value system of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind so that you begin to value what God wants for everyone. And I really mean that, for everyone. That's what the apostle said. He said, I'm obligated to the Greek and the non-Greek. In other words, to everyone. He says that the good news of Jesus Christ came first to the Jew and then to the Gentile. He's interchanging the term Greek and Gentile here to mean the same thing. Non-Jews. If you really want to know the truth, I don't know everyone's genealogy in this room right now. I really don't. But I suspect a number of you don't fit into either of those categories. You're neither a Greek nor a Gentile. Those are terms for the people around the Mediterranean. If you are Italian, then yes, that you would fit into that. Or if you are Greek, my good friend who lives across the street from us, Steve Poulos, is Greek. He's very active in the Greek Orthodox Church, and the gospel made its inroads to the people around the Mediterranean. Many of you, your ancestors were further out in Northern Europe or far to the west on the British Isles. And for us, we were in neither of those categories. We were still yet another category of people that the gospel had yet to come to at this point. But the point Paul is making is that God intends it to be for everyone. Good news for everyone. That your sins can be forgiven and will be. That you have hope to live a life where you are valued for what's in your soul, not simply for what your body looks like. Not only for how much you can eat and throw up and eat some more. Not only for how much wine you can hold. Not only for how you can cause someone else to have pleasure in your presence. Those are not the things that God wants valued. God wants the value of a person to be deeper than that. I'm not ashamed of the gospel. It's the power of God unto salvation. And he says that the wickedness of human beings, we translate the word anthropos in Greek with the word in English man. It really is most accurately translated in this particular case, humanity, to mean all people. This entire text is aimed at and for all people. But he says that the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness, that's a lack of faith in God, and wickedness of human beings who suppress the truth by their wickedness. So what is the truth? The truth is that we were put on this earth to be loved. Loved by God, valued for who we are in our soul, and put in a context in which we had opportunity to love one another. Let me ask you a question. Why are we talking about helping one of our young women with a problem she ran into on her way home from here to Arizona, and now she's waylaid in Chicago? How's that our problem? It is. Because she's one of us. This is one of our kids. Taught Haley in my confirmation class. Have delighted in watching her grow into the woman that she is. And we all do. And that's just one example. We have so many. We all take great delight in watching our young people grow and prosper and learn and make a way for themselves. Why? Because we love them. That's why. And we were put into this context to love them and to love one another and to stand by in comfort when families, like we've prayed for this morning, have had to say goodbye to special people. Why? Because we love them. And we love the ones they love because they matter. And God has said, it is my will that they should have value in their soul and that they should matter and that they should be loved. And the suppression of godlessness of that truth is what the apostle is taking aim at today. We could talk about what wickedness means, and I've made some references to it, okay? So the practices of the Roman Empire. I don't think it's a big problem in this room. I doubt that any of you has a vomitorium in your home. I doubt that you eat till you're full, go and throw up, and then eat some more just for the sake of it. I don't think that's a big problem here. I don't think that Oak Hill Church is a place where, you know, we have had a widespread problem with sexual immorality and group sexual practice and all the other things that we've made passing reference to here today that are just manifestations of the wickedness that takes root when there is godlessness. But here's one thing that I think church families everywhere need to pay attention to. I'm gonna leave us with this today. There is a wickedness about what we do with our mouth. And I think it exists in churches because churches are groups of people, because I think it exists in every group of people. Social organizations where people find themselves in proximity with one another on a regular basis. Country clubs, yacht clubs. It would be the same at school faculties. Don, I think you could probably tell us stories about school faculties and people who teach together, work together, or hospitals where people are on staff together and the nursing staff. And whenever there's a group of people that are in proximity with one another on a regular basis, eventually they start talking about one another. And that's the word about is the problem there. One of the manifestations of wickedness that I see that I think the church has to wage war against is what we do with our words regarding one another. For one thing, if someone starts to talk to you about someone, a great question to ask them immediately is, have you talked to this person? Because a lot of times, not all the time, sometimes we're talking about someone, we're concerned about them. We're sharing a concern with another person or asking for advice, how can I help, so on and so forth. I don't think there's a big problem there, but a lot of the time when we're talking about someone instead of to someone, we find ourselves veering off into an area of sin that is gossip. When we're spreading information, disinformation, or rumors that are aimed at assassinating someone's character, at lessening their standing in the group, at making them appear to be foolish, many times without regard for whether or not what is being said is true, we're veering off into an area of wickedness that suppresses God's truth. Because God's truth is that love builds up, not tears down. Love builds up. Knowledge might puff up, but love builds up. Are we building one another? I encourage you, if someone starts that and you hear it, to say, stop. Now, have you talked about your concerns with that sister, with that brother? Have you shared with them what you're upset about? And if so, if they didn't respond well to that, did you go back with another person and the two of you try to talk to them? Because that's what in Matthew 18 Jesus told us to do if we love one another. Let's try to make this right. We start one-on-one, then we'll try two-on-one, and then maybe get a group of folks together. I think the psychologists call that an intervention, right? Well, Jesus had that idea 2,000 years ago. Sometimes people don't really have at interest making things right, having concerns, making things right. There are times that people use this instrument right here intentionally to tear down and take aim, even at fellow Christians. It ought not to be. But we know it's human nature and we know that it happens. Sometimes it happens with misinformation. Sometimes it happens and people say things that have been proved not to be true, yet they continue to still say them, just like Herr Goebbels taught the Nazi regime. You tell the big lie long enough, it becomes the substitute truth. The church is the place where that should stop. That should end. We give no quarter to that kind of thing. But unfortunately, and what church am I talking about? Am I talking about Oak Hill Church? Not so much, but it could happen anywhere. I'm talking about every church. The church at Rome, the church in Cleveland, the church in Memphis. Anywhere that people gather in groups, the world has in it the presence of the imperfections of humanity. And every place that the imperfections of humanity take root, we will find a wickedness that suppresses the truth, because things start to happen which get in the way of the message God intended from the first place. And that is, I love them. For God so loved the world, he gave his only Son, that whoever would believe in him. And the message today from the apostle says that this message is for everyone who believes. That it is good news. And that good news is that you have value because you are loved, and that you are meant to be put in a church family where that love will take root and you will be built up by the love of God shared through the lives of people who have learned the truth, who know the truth, and practice that truth. That we look around at our brothers and our sisters in the church, and we know they have value. And when they have a problem, we have a problem. And when they have a joy or a success, we share in their joy and their success. Because we are the people of God. Just as surely as the Lord put the sun in the sky, and meant for the warmth and the light to be for everyone, the Lord sent his Son to the earth and meant for his warmth and his light to be for everyone. And so it shall be for all who believe and all who find fellowship and quarter with us, steeped in his love. Thanks be to God for this, a living word. And let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the gospel. We are not ashamed of the gospel. It is not a crutch for us. It is our refuge. It is the launching point for us to have a life that truly prospers, not necessarily with material things, but with spiritual things and relationships that change the way we see the world and change the way we live. We pray, dear God, that having been planted in the gospel, we would be agents of your love. That we would be the ones that stifle the wickedness of the tongue, that change the course of the conversations from those that tear down to those that build up. And we pray that you would help us in our efforts to be authentic in our discipleship for Jesus Christ. For we trust and we pray in his name. Amen. Perfectly and appropriately, hymn 403 is "What a Friend We Have in Jesus." And if you feel physically able to do so, would you stand to sing at this time? Picnic is on the 7th. It is next week. I thought it was. The church picnic will be next week after church in the parking lot. One week from today, then, sacrament of the Lord's Supper. Hopefully, some of our brothers and sisters who are traveling will have returned safely to our fellowship. We look forward to that. We do have our picnic, so lots to look forward to. Until that time, the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance on you and give to you his peace this day and forevermore. Amen. Thank you.
Thank you.